My name is Angel Collado Schwartz. I'm an historian, an entrepreneur, and a professor of history at one of the top graduate schools in Puerto Rico. Yes, Puerto Rico is a colony since 1492, when the Spaniards conquered Puerto Rico and colonized Puerto Rico, effective 1508. And since then, we've been a colony for 400 years under the Spanish rule, and since 1898, when the United States invaded Puerto Rico as part of the Spanish-American War, it became a USA colony. Well, it is a very, very important element as far as the Puerto Ricans, because after being a colony for 500 years, everything goes around the metropolis. Puerto Rico is run from Washington in the sense that Congress has plenary powers over Puerto Rico. So all the laws approved by Congress are enforceable in Puerto Rico without the consent of the Puerto Ricans or the consent of representatives of Puerto Rico in Congress. We don't have any voting representative in Congress, only one member of the House of Representatives who is a non-voting member. That's it. We don't have anything in the Senate. So whatever laws are approved in Washington are enforceable in Puerto Rico. So everything, the court system, the attorney generals, are part of them are from the United States, and they were appointed by a president, not elected by the Puerto Ricans, and confirmed by Congress without the consent of the Puerto Ricans. Well, as far as perceived options, we have, for example, statehood. Statehood, people think in Puerto Rico that it's an option Puerto Ricans have, and that is incorrect. The option of statehood rests in the United States. They are the ones who decide whether Puerto Rico would become a state or not. And since 1898, the United States have been very clear that Puerto Rico is the objective of Puerto Rico, the mission of Puerto Rico, is not to become a state of the Union. That is why the Supreme Court in the insular cases at the beginning of the century decided and defined the relationship with Puerto Rico as an unincorporated territory that belongs but is not part of the United States. The difference between incorporated and unincorporated is that the incorporated are going to eventually become a state of the Union. For example, Hawaii and Alaska, they were incorporated territories. Puerto Rico is not.
Why?
Because the United States had no intention of annexing Puerto Rico to their country. And the United States invaded Puerto Rico because they needed to protect the eastern gate of the Panama Canal. The western gate was protected by Hawaii. So that was the main reason why the United States came to Puerto Rico back in 1898. And it was Captain Mahan who was the first geopolitician who wrote about this thinking, about this strategy of the United States. And President Theodore Roosevelt agreed with him, and he implemented the strategy that included building a canal in Panama and reinforcing and protecting the two gates of the canal. Statehood is available to all Puerto Ricans, not to Puerto Rico. Anybody who wants to achieve statehood have 50 states to choose. So they can go to the airport in Puerto Rico and just be able to get statehood and secure statehood in any of the 50 states. That's not so for Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is a separate nation. Puerto Rico is a Spanish-speaking Latin American nation in the Caribbean. Puerto Rico is not United States. United States is another nation. And Puerto Rico, again, you know, if you're Puerto Rican and you want statehood, you can go there, no problem. And I don't say this, you know, in a negative way. I think I'm saying this in a realistic way. I am not anti-American. You know, I consider myself pro-American. But I think this is two nations, United States and Puerto Rico, and two nations that can be and can have an extraordinary relationship that would benefit both parts. Well, the opinion of the U.S. presidents regarding the status of Puerto Rico is their personal opinion. However, the presidents of the United States have no power as far as deciding the status of Puerto Rico. According to the U.S. Constitution, only Congress have plenary powers over the territories. So only Congress. It's very interesting that in 1989, George H.W. Bush, in his first State of the Union message in 1989, he said, I'm going to solve the problem of Puerto Rico status. I endorse statehood. However, I am willing to accept whatever the Puerto Rican people prefer. He asked Congress to start having hearings about the status of Puerto Rico. And interesting enough, the three political parties in Puerto Rico supported Bush on this initiative. That means the statehooders, the Commonwealth, that at that point in time, the Commonwealth Party was in control of the government in Puerto Rico, and the Independence Party. So when people say, oh, the Puerto Ricans, they don't get together, they don't have their act together, wrong. In 1989, everybody was in agreement. There was consensus between Puerto Rico and the President of the United States. And then it was approved unanimously by the House of Representatives in the United States. And then the whole process died and was derailed at the Senate committee in charge of territories. And they derailed it with a vote of 10 to 10. So that means both parties, Democrats and Republicans, derail the process. According to the New York Times, the reason why it was derailed is that Congress was not willing to offer statehood to Puerto Rico in the event Puerto Ricans would ask for statehood in the plebiscite. Because the whole project was to have a, first it was a binding plebiscite, then they changed it to make it into a non-binding plebiscite. So there is a proof that it doesn't matter whether the president agrees, disagrees, the whole process is blocked in Congress, particularly the Senate. The plebiscite this year, in 2012, it's a little bit awkward in the way it was, the bill was drafted. And it is the fourth plebiscite in the history of Puerto Rico. First one was 1967, 1993, 1998, 2012. And we can discuss whether it's a charade, whether it's worthless. However, the plebiscite exists, will take place tomorrow. And we have to remember that this, the results of the plebiscite will be part of the file of Puerto Rico. This plebiscite, I think it's very important for Puerto Rico. Why? Because for the first time in our history, we are going to be telling the United States whether we want to maintain the current status with the United States. That first part of the plebiscite that says yes and no means, do you want to continue to be a territory of the United States or a colony of the United States? Yes and no. If the people say yes, I think that will derail again the whole status issue. I think it will be another generation, the one who will deal with the status problem. I will stay in Culebra. And I don't think we have a road plan if that is the result of the plebiscite. If people decide that they want to maintain the current status. However, if the no wins, then it's a new ballgame. It really doesn't matter, in a way, who is the governor of Puerto Rico. Because we will have a mandate from the people of Puerto Rico to tell Congress that we want to reopen the case of Puerto Rico, which I think we have to do that, because first of all, we're in the 21st century. The geopolitical, military, strategic reasons for the United States being in the Caribbean doesn't exist anymore. There's no Cold War anymore. And the center, the geopolitical center of the U.S. foreign policy is the Middle East and Asia, not the Caribbean, not Latin America. So the United States do not have any reason to have Puerto Rico as a colony, as it has been. I think it is in the best interest of the United States that Puerto Rico be a self-sufficient country that would depend less and less and less of any federal transfers, and that Puerto Rico becomes the Singapore of Latin America. That should be our north. That should be our aim. And to maintain a relationship with the United States like the former territories in the Pacific, okay, where Puerto Rico would be a sovereign country in close association with the United States. Puerto Rico's relationship with the United States is for life. We cannot, you know, some people do not like that, but tough luck, because we have over 100 years of relationship. We have more people who are descendants of Puerto Ricans in the United States than in Puerto Rico. Everybody in Puerto Rico have a cousin, a friend, a relative in the United States. So that relation is forever. However, the current situation where Puerto Rico is a welfare state dependent on the United States economically is not good. It's not good for the United States, it's not good for Puerto Rico. We have to find a solution that would be good for both parts. And unfortunately, the politicians don't want to solve it. Why? Because the politicians in Puerto Rico, what they want is power. They want, their objective is to win the elections, not to deal with the status issue. And then the American politicians, they are not interested, because all they care is their elections, and then they are influenced by lobbyists that Puerto Rico hires, or by their fundraising element for their campaigns. So according to who's in power in Puerto Rico, they put the lobbyists to achieve what they want and raise funds for the campaigns of the congressmen. So that's why we are in a deadlock right now. It's a dead-end street right now as it is. And I think it's not, you might say, well, why should we change it? Because we are polarizing Puerto Rico, and that's not good. In the 1950s, there was violence in Puerto Rico. Some Puerto Ricans tried to kill President Harry S. Truman in 1950. That was a year of the Puerto Rican Revolution that took place in several cities in Puerto Rico and in Washington. And then in 1954, where they shot at the U.S. Congress. And it's unfortunate. You know, I don't believe in violence. I don't think it's should be an option for Puerto Rican, and much less to solve our relationship with the United States. I think we have to find a solution, and solutions are found discussing it. But you cannot have political agendas or personal agendas that I want to accomplish this because I want to be in power. That should not be an option. We should not mix one thing with the other. We need to have maybe a constitutional assembly in Puerto Rico where people are elected and become part of the assembly to decide what should be done for Puerto Rico. I think it's pathetic that Puerto Ricans graduate from extraordinary universities in Puerto Rico and they have to leave because we don't have job opportunities. That is bad. You know, this is a society that in the 1950s was growing, was very healthy economically, but the economic model is finished. It's finished because of the status. For example, you know, we had the pharmaceutical industry. We had we were the capital of the pharmaceutical world, industry, of the pharmaceutical industry, and then the pharmaceutical industry was penalized when Congress eliminated the 936 tax provision. So Congress gave us that, Congress took it away. That proves who is in charge of Puerto Rico. They ruin our economy, they help it, and then ruin it. 936, you know, the pharmaceutical industry, after the elimination of the tax provision by Congress, what has happened is that as the company's patents expire, they move out of Puerto Rico. They move out of Puerto Rico and they move to Singapore or Ireland. Why? Because Singapore and Ireland have treaties with the United States. And it is in their benefit, it is in the company's benefit to move to those countries. We cannot have treaties with the United States because we are not sovereign. We're a territory. And as a territory, we have to go to Congress and plead and beg for things that would help the economy. That is not a dignified situation for a country in the 21st century. In a globalized economy with high tech controlling the world, Puerto Rico cannot continue surviving as a welfare state because we are in a free fall. And the only solution for Puerto Rico with the current status is more welfare for Puerto Rico. Is that in the best interest of the U.S. taxpayers and of the U.S. foreign policy? No. We have to remember that the statehood governments in Puerto Rico have ruined the economic model of Puerto Rico. For example, in 1968, the first statehood governor was elected in Puerto Rico because of a division of the Commonwealth Party. And Luis Ferré became governor. One of the things he did, of his measures during his government, was to bring the food stamps program to Puerto Rico. Obviously, that was very popular. That won votes for him. So it was a populist move. However, that started the welfare problem we have in Puerto Rico, where every day people get more welfare. How do we get it? Because the government of Puerto Rico hires lobbyists, raises funds for the campaigns of congressmen for Puerto Rico to receive more aid. I need to stress one thing, that Congress has so much power about territories, on territories, that they can give a territory any amount of money they want. For example, Congress cannot favor Massachusetts versus Texas because the Constitution of the United States is very clear that you have to assign funds proportionally to the amount of residents. That rule does not apply to territories. So they can give Puerto Rico 10 times more, which is not the case, or 10 times less. So what is the element that gives Congress, that Congress has to assign monies to Puerto Rico or the territories? Fundraising for their campaigns or the effectiveness of lobbyist programs in Washington. So that's how we got into the trap of the welfare with the food stamp. First governor, first statehood governor in the history of Puerto Rico, elected.
And also Republican,
yes. Ironically, Republicans, because supposedly Republicans want less welfare. Okay?
We can talk about those ironies later on.
Right. And then the second statehood governor, Carlos Romero Barceló, what was one of his contributions? He implemented the federal minimum wage in Puerto Rico. Everybody applauded. People were very happy. Populist move. But what happened? That ruined the economic model of Puerto Rico. Because I'm not saying that we should not have higher wages for the employees. I think we should have higher than the federal minimum wage. That would be our goal. That should be our goal. However, not force it. Because Puerto Rico at that time was not ready to implement the federal minimum wage. However, no politician would dare say that because the people would be furious they want to make more money without realizing that the idea, and Muñoz Marín, in his State of the Union messages here in Puerto Rico, he always said that it was better to have more people working at less salary than a few at a higher salary. Because unemployment creates a major problem for society. Crime is related with unemployment. Drug addiction is related with unemployment. If you're unemployed, you cannot pay for a private school. You cannot pay for a health plan. You're more dependent on the government, aside from the fact that you are providing the wrong and the terrible example to the new generation of having a father drinking beer in the corner instead of having a decent work. So this has a major social implications for Puerto Rico. That's why unemployment should be the top priority of any government in Puerto Rico. And then the third elected statehood governor, Pedro Rosselló, he eliminated the 936. Okay, I once was in Washington and I was with one of the most important corporations in the United States, head of government affairs in Washington. And this person had a lot of, the company had a lot of industries in Puerto Rico then, which is General Electric. And then she said to me, "I don't understand why your governor betrayed us in supporting 936 for Puerto Rico. Because once he said, I'm against 936, you know, we, the corporations, came out, you know, without blanket, and we lost the fight with Congress. And it was a statehood governor. Why? Because he did not want Puerto Rico to have any benefits versus other states of the Union. So, supposedly, he could get the support of those states for Puerto Rico to become a state. So, in other words, he preferred Puerto Rico to be ruined economically if that is what it takes for Puerto Rico to become a state. I think it's the opposite. You know, I think that if you're a statehooder and you want Puerto Rico to become a state, you should make Puerto Rico extremely profitable and should make Puerto Rico a model, economic model, rather than a welfare state. And then the current governor, who is Luis Fortuño, he, instead of creating jobs, he increased the unemployment. So the economic model of Puerto Rico today, it's in its worst position. So what I'm saying is that the four elected statehood governors have ruined the economic model of Puerto Rico that could have worked very well for them and for statehood, and they ruined it. So I think the greatest enemies of statehood have been the statehood governors of Puerto Rico, and more so, particularly this new government, the current government of Puerto Rico, that have assumed anti-American positions. For example, could you imagine that the president of the United States would attack the New York Times and say that he should close the New York Times? That's what has happened here with the president of the Senate. In the case of the way the students were treated, nowhere in the United States they would treat students and throw the police that the Civil Liberties Union in the United States have criticized the police of Puerto Rico for mistreating the students. Take, for example, the case of the way they treat opposition. You know, to have, again, the Senate in Puerto Rico turn off the microphone when the minority leader is speaking. Could you imagine that happening in Congress? This government, in my opinion, have more similarities with old-time dictatorships like Trujillo in Dominican Republic, Somoza in Nicaragua, Batista in Cuba, than with the United States. I think they're the opposite of Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and James Madison. I don't know the First Lady personally. However, everybody knows, and this is public record, that she is a practicing attorney as First Lady, and that she does closings for mortgages, cancellation of deeds, and that her income is about $1 million a year. Okay, could you imagine Michelle Obama, who is a prominent lawyer, graduated from Harvard, practicing law from the White House? Or could you imagine Hillary Clinton, when she was First Lady, again, another lawyer, graduated from Yale University, practicing law while being First Lady? And again, here we have that. That action is more like a Latin American dictatorship than like the United States. I consider myself more pro-American than the statehooders, than some statehooders in Puerto Rico. People who believe in and support independence of Puerto Rico, and or even Commonwealth, who would be more in tune with the principles of the founding fathers of the United States. I think that in both options, independence and sovereignty, which is free association, both of them are out of the territorial clause. The United States Constitution is very clear that you have two types of relationships with the United States. One as a state of the Union, and the second one as a territory. Okay? And those are the only two options. So when Puerto Ricans say, for example, oh, Puerto Rico is not a territory, some Puerto Rican politicians claim that Puerto Rico is not a territory, then I ask them, then it must be a state. I don't see Puerto Rico among the 50 states. Okay, so where are we? It's one of the two. The U.S. Constitution do not have another option called ELA. It doesn't exist. So either you're a state or your territory, and if you are neither, then you're a sovereign country. As Peter Rosenblatt, who was the ambassador in charge of the negotiations of the United States and its territories in the Pacific during Jimmy Carter's presidency, he said at a press conference in Washington, someone asked him about things that could be negotiated in the free association, and Peter said, everything's negotiable. Everything. And independence, everything's negotiable. The similarities between free association and independence is that both are sovereign. Sovereign countries with relationship with the United States. The difference between free association and independence is that free association has a very, very close relationship with the United States. Independence, not necessarily. My complaint with the word independence is that independence is a term of the 19th century, when countries were becoming independent, etc. When the United Nations was founded, it had 45 members. Today, it has almost 200 members. So that gives you an idea of where the trend is. The trend is towards sovereign countries. In today's world, no one is independent. Is the United States independent? No. You know, China owns the biggest percent of the debt of the United States. United States is the principal market of China. So is China independent? No. Is Canada independent? No. Is Mexico independent? No. Everybody is interdependent. So that's why I think to communicate or to try to sell the concept of independence is awkward and passé, and should have no reality in Puerto Rico. It's not a good term. I think the key thing is sovereignty. And there are two options, independence or free association. I support free association in close alliance with the United States. And I think it is in the best interest of the United States. Throughout the history of Puerto Rico, the politicians have been telling Puerto Rico, oh, Puerto Rico could never be an independent country. Because look at Haiti. Luca, and they use the worst examples. And it's like you telling your son, you cannot go out of the street because a car can kill you. Look at what happened to a neighbor. He was killed by a car. That means he couldn't go out of the house? No. I think that you have to tell him, go out on the street and then look at both sides and make sure a car doesn't run you. So I think that what I try to do in the book is bring successful models for Puerto Rico. Countries, and I mentioned in one of the introductions of the book that Lester Thoreau, who used to be the director of the economics department at MIT, was in Puerto Rico about 20 years ago, and he had a conference that I attended, and he was the first guy who said, listen, you should look at Singapore as a model for Puerto Rico. Weeks later, I was in the business world then, and we had a meeting in Singapore. So I went for the first time to Singapore, and then I took a day off and went and met with the director of the economics department at the University of Singapore. And then I asked her about the model of Singapore, and I was surprised that she told me, listen, we copy things from Puerto Rico, because the tax incentive plan, the Fomento, the Puerto Rico industrial company, industrial development company, they copy our model in Singapore. And then I thought, what happened? What went wrong? And then that's when I thought about the statehood governors who brought welfare to Puerto Rico to make people like the United States and support statehood. Even Romero Barceló, the statehood governor, he repackaged statehood, saying statehood is for the poor people. If you want more federal aid and welfare, we have to be a state. Could you imagine how the United States would feel if they learned that the Puerto Ricans supported all of a sudden statehood because they can get more welfare? Could you imagine that you would be in the process of getting married and then you learn that your girl, all she's interested in is in your money? No, Puerto Rico is very different from the other territories, other four territories, in the sense that Puerto Rico is a nation. Those other territories are not nations. And you have, for example, the case of Guam. Guam is about 100,000 people, 120,000. And they are a big percent of the population are not people from Guam. So their situation is different. They have an independence movement there, but the situation of Guam is completely different to Puerto Rico. They have also a major military presence there. They have, I remember when I visited the island years back, I was impressed with the shopping centers that are tailored for the Japanese. The Japanese go to Guam to buy and purchase for shopping. So it's different. They don't have beautiful beaches also for some reason, because they're in the Pacific, and the Pacific have extraordinary beaches in Palau, in Tahiti, but not in Guam. And then our next door neighbor, the Virgin Islands. Virgin Islands was acquired from Denmark by the United States in 1917, and it was a Danish territory. Colony, and that was highly populated with blacks from Africa. So because the sugar plantation was very important, so they had to import a lot of slaves from Africa. So their situation is different. You know, they speak English, and it's not a nation. Virgin Islands is not a nation. They have, as a matter of fact, different islands, particularly St. Croix, St. John, St. Thomas are different. They have some racial problems. So it's different. Puerto Rico is a 4 million Spanish-speaking nation in the Caribbean. And Puerto Rico is, together with Cuba and Dominican Republic, it is the three major Spanish-speaking nations in the Caribbean. Hawaii is a very interesting case in the sense that it was part of the military strategy of the United States, together with Puerto Rico, of protecting the gates of the Panama Canal. That was the West Gate. So the United States sent some missionaries to try to work out something with to penetrate the society by means of religion. Recently, President Clinton signed an apology approved by Congress to the Hawaiian people because the United States orchestrated a coup d'etat against the Queen of Hawaii. And it's all part of history that the United States sent some Marines to take over the country, and then eventually sent planters and landowners to develop the sugar and pineapple in Hawaii, which, by the way, the same companies were in Puerto Rico, and there's all kinds of stories written in history books about how these companies took some Puerto Rican workers to Hawaii, and it was almost like slavery, the way they took them in planes in the southern coast of Puerto Rico, and the families didn't know where they were going. All of a sudden, they disappeared, and they went to Hawaii. So their history is different. And then the reason why they want statehood, it's very interesting, and had to do with Alaska, because they were both incorporated territories. So from the beginning, United States saw that they would be going towards statehood when the United States didn't say. However, what happened is that Alaska, United States wanted to incorporate Alaska, which they had acquired in the previous century from Russia, because United States was afraid of the Russians in the Cold War. We have to see that after World War II, the Cold War was limited in Europe. And then in 1950, the Cold War expanded to Asia in the Korean War. And then China had a major change in government, and Mao Zedong took over. So all of a sudden, you had Russia and China, both communist countries, against the United States. And then United States, Alaska, by means of Alaska, and Russia are very close. And remember that on World War II, Alaska was occupied. The islands at the very end of Alaska was occupied by Japan. So that triggered the United States to have an interest in pursuing statehood for Alaska. What happened is that some senators did not want Alaska statehood because they thought that it was not the local Alaskan. You know, they had some Americans from the United States already there populating Alaska. So there was opposition in the Senate to make Alaska state and assign them two senators as all the other states. So what happened and what changed everything, again, the first thing was the Cold War. The second was the discovery of oil. Because the greatest opposition for state of Alaska was headed by Lyndon B. Johnson, who was Senate Majority Leader then, and by Sam Rayburn, who was Speaker of the House. Both were from Texas. So what happened? When they discovered oil, the Texan companies started investing in Alaska to get oil in Alaska. And then they obviously forced Lyndon B. Johnson and Sam Rayburn to forget about their opposition for Alaska statehood. Okay? And that's what happened. They didn't vote in favor, but they abstained. And they let the bill pass. There was a problem that the two senators at that time from Alaska were going to be Republicans. So the Senate was worried of unbalancing the power play between Democrats and Republicans in the Senate, which is the most powerful political body in the world, and most exclusive, and most undemocratic, because the two senators from California, who represent over 30 million people, have exactly the same power as the two senators from Wyoming, who represent 500,000 people. So that balance, they were worried. So they discovered that Alaska was Democrats at that point in time. The two senators from Alaska were going to be Democrats. And then they needed to balance that with Hawaii, with two senators who were from the Republican Party. So that's how they invited Hawaii. All through Harry S. Truman's presidency from 1945 to 1952, he supported statehood for both territories. However, that didn't fly. It was not until Eisenhower became president, and at the end of his term, that he was able to approve it in Congress, because again, it's not the president who gives statehood, it's Congress. And they approve it for this reason I told you. If Puerto Rico would become a state, Puerto Rico would have more congressmen, more members in the House of Representatives than more than half of the states of the Union. Okay? So all of a sudden, Puerto Rico would have, I believe, 7, 8 congressmen and 2 senators. Most probably all of them would be Democrats. So that would change the political balance in Congress. And that is something that the Republicans would oppose. On the other hand, I think that if Puerto Rico would approve a statehood bill or would support statehood, the United States would have to take into consideration the percent of people who do not support statehood in Puerto Rico. What would you do with those people, okay, who would be the intellectuals, the professionals, hard workers? Because again, as I mentioned, the statehood governor has, and the statehood party have claim, and their war cry is that statehood is for the poor people. So the majority of the statehood would be welfare recipients. So what would you do with the people who oppose statehood? Do you want to polarize Puerto Rico? Do you want to have an opposition like Quebec, like in Ireland? Do you want that? When you have and you're offering all Puerto Rican statehood. So it's not an issue of civil liberties. Anybody who wants to be a part of a state can go. They can choose 50 states. What are you going to do with the people who are pro-Americans who live in Puerto Rico but do not want to become a state because Puerto Rico is a different nation? What are you going to do with that people, with those people? What are you going to do? I think every American should ask themselves, why is it good for the United States to make Puerto Rico into the 51st state of the Union? What's in it for the United States? And I cannot find one single reason, because Puerto Rico would be the poorest state of the Union, less per capita income than Mississippi, which is the poorest state, and it will create a problem with the polarization in Puerto Rico. What are you going to do with the people who oppose statehood in Puerto Rico, who are the intellectuals, the professionals, the hard workers, etc.? And then if Puerto Rico would become a state, it will cost a fortune to the United States, because the welfare payments of Puerto Rico are not the same as the welfare payments to a state of the Union. So all of a sudden, United States would have to equal Puerto Rico, because as a territory, United States Congress can assign any amount to a territory, but not to a state. To a state, it have to be proportional to the population. So that means Puerto Rico, United States would have to inject millions and billions of dollars to Puerto Rico to support the welfare system in Puerto Rico. Okay? So it doesn't make sense. What I'm saying is, Let's sit down and let's find a solution to the problem that would be a win-win. Win for the United States, win for Puerto Rico, and win for the Puerto Rican stakeholders, because the Puerto Rican stakeholders, again, they have 50 states, they can move. Okay, so there's no problem. But that, I think, is the way to solve the problem of Puerto Rico and have a long-term friendship, relationship. The strongest ally of the United States in the Caribbean will be Puerto Rico. Also, we have to consider that very soon the Caribbean will change, because eventually, the embargo of Cuba will end. And I think Puerto Rico could make an extraordinary alliance with Cuba post-Castro, obviously. So I think, as you know, there's no country that have more similarities with Puerto Rico culturally and historically than Cuba. Both countries were the last two colonies of Spain in the New World. Both countries had an independence revolutionary party headquartered in New York City, where the leaders of both countries were in New York, and there they created the flag, which is exactly the same flag, Puerto Rico and Cuba, with reverse colors. And Puerto Rico have a long-time, historical relation with Cuba, that, because of the Cold War, have been frozen, and the fact of Fidel Castro's revolution. However, I'm talking about the period post-Castro. He's not eternal, you know, and eventually will open up. And I think it's a great opportunity for the world, for the region, to have a close relationship between these two important islands. So I think it's in the best interest of the United States to establish a new relationship with Puerto Rico based on sovereignty for Puerto Rico, a close association between the two countries, and using Singapore as the economic model for Puerto Rico, and using Palau and the Marshall Islands as the political model as far as the relationship, a compact of free association between the two countries, just as it was done in the Pacific. Those islands are very small, so as far as economic models, I don't think they would be economic models for Puerto Rico, because they're far behind Puerto Rico. So I think the economic model of Puerto Rico is Singapore, and Puerto Rico should be the Singapore of the Americas. We are living in a new world. New world that is globalized, that it's high tech, and Puerto Rico's relationship with the United States, it's more in tune with the 19th century and 20th century. It is a colonial relationship where Congress approves laws enforceable in Puerto Rico without the consent of the Puerto Ricans. And I think the time has come for United States and Puerto Rico to find a solution to this situation, mainly because the island is in a free fall economically, the quality of life is not here, and we are in a dead-end street with the current status. So I think the opportunity is now to redefine the relationship that would be in the best interest of the United States and the best interest of Puerto Rico for both parties. Statehood will not happen because the United States is not in their best interest to make Puerto Rico, to make a Spanish-speaking nation part of the United States. The colonial situation is not good because we don't have the economic model to make Puerto Rico into a self-sufficient country. And the current situation incorporates more and more welfare for Puerto Rico. And then I think the opportunity is for Puerto Rico to become the Singapore of the Americas, an island that is 14 times smaller than Puerto Rico with more than 1 million people. And to establish a political relationship based in the model of the former territories of the United States in the Pacific, the Palau Islands, the Marshall Islands, Micronesia, and establish that relationship with between the United States and Puerto Rico. That is the best solution for both parties. And again, we have to provide sovereignty to Puerto Rico in close alliance with the United States and find a solution and a formula that would be in the best interest of both the United States and Puerto Rico.